components which go to make up just one car. How many in all? Close on 20,000. 20,000 component parts, the sum total of whose reliability is the measure of the comfort you enjoy, the speed with safety to which you are entitled.
These, by the way, are Morris Minors. Produced by the Nuffield organization, they are one of the world's smallest cars, but are also among the world's sturdiest travelers.
Takes all the family and our luggage in comfort. It's very economical too, but you see, it's a Morris.
My family, and this is my fleet, and it's a wonderful change for me when I finish my work, because I put away my high technology Boeing and get into my Morris Minor, which is a marvelous simple piece of machinery that works first time every time.
I drive a Morris Minor, not really for nostalgia, I think, but because I like something dependable and ongoing and complicated and fairly basic in what I feel is a fairly disposable age.
At this factory, in Cowley, in 1948, the brand new Morris Minor rolled off the tracks. 1,288,000 cars, and 23 years later, production ceased. NWL 576 was the first. It may look out of place now. It may not fit into an industry whose models change every 4 or 5 years. But there's still over 100,000 Morris Minors in everyday use around the world.
Well, I've had Morris Minors and travelers and convertibles for years now. I have more years than I really like to think. I'm not actually really a car fan at all. I don't like cars. I think they're a bit like a hair shirt in a way, and that one has to assume them like a mantle of penance. And to me, I think they ought to be cold and drafty and uncomfortable. But I like these. But I like their individuality. The styling, the simplicity, really.
In 1919, we brought down the price of motor cars by £100 per car on each of our models. From that date, you will find that most other motor car manufacturers in this country followed suit. We therefore claim the credit of bringing cheap motoring to the public of Great Britain and the colonies.
The original Morris Minor was unveiled in 1928 as the small car of the Morris range. But it was never a serious threat to its main rival, the Austin 7, and only stayed in production for 6 years. In 1940, work started on its successor. The new car took shape on the sketch pad of a young engineer, Alec Izzigonis.
He wasn't really able to have a conversation without having a pencil in his hand and drawing and sketching whatever he wanted to talk about. The number of linen tablecloths that he ruined during lunchtime when he was talking for Legion, he would insist on drawing with his pencil on the cloth.
Eventually, Izzigonis was joined by a small team of engineers at the experimental department in Cowley.
This is the interesting one.
Yes,
that's Izzigonis' office.
That's
there.
Alec.
Let's have a look inside it, shall we? Good God, it looks different now.
It does, doesn't it? No.
Remember the old drawing
board? No drawing
board.
No, nothing. You have to come and get get your instructions from
here,
do we?
Yeah.
That's right.
Wish I could get inside there now.
Yes, it's a shame, isn't it, really? Yes. I was thinking of a brilliant designer.
Oh, brilliant idea, yes.
A brilliant brain he got as well, hadn't he?
An idealist.
Yes,
an idealist. That's what he was.
He wasn't worried about salaries or anything like that. He wanted, didn't want to get involved, did he? It was just cars and design. That's all he had in his head.
Is it?
Just cars and design.
Sure thing.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Here is a clever cinematographic illusion to show you how a car is built up. First of all, the front axle and wheels, then the back axle and transmission, then the engine.
The small cars of their time were designed, were scaled-down versions of big cars. The engine was way back behind the axle, vintage-like, and there was hardly anywhere to sit. When we did the Morris Minor, I thought to myself, well, look, if we're going to make a small car, we've got to have a new concept altogether. So we put the engine in front of the axle, and then there was room for people to sit.
To save weight, the body and chassis were integrated into one unit, a monocoque. Rack and pinion steering and independent front suspension would give the car a sporty feel. Isigonis was obsessive about every aspect of the design.
I remember once, which seemed rather ridiculous to me, he said, Reg, I think that's 3/8 of an inch too high. Now, 3/8 of an inch is ridiculous, isn't it? I mean, you put another bit of padding underneath the seat cover and you've got that, haven't you? He was very, very fussy about things like that. It's got to be just right, you know.
After 1945, the Morris factory went back into production with its pre-war range. Britain was desperately short of foreign currency, and raw materials were strictly rationed. Car manufacturers were warned that they would have to export or die. When Lord Nuffield saw the new car, he was typically blunt.
Basically, he said that he thought the thing looks like a poached egg and was narrow-gutted. And I remember that the people in the department then worked all through the night and cut the car in half and put another 3 or 4 inches, I think it was 4 inches, down the centre of the vehicle, which made all the difference in the world to its appearance and ultimately, of course, to its road holding.
Well, this is it before they put the 4 inches in.
That's right.
Can you imagine they split it right down the middle, and then they pulled the two halves apart until it was aesthetically right in their eyes.
That's right.
You see it in the bonnet, you can see it in the front bumper, but elsewhere it's all tucked away quite nicely, you
That's
can't
right.
see a thing.
Yes, it is. It's quite right.
Yeah.
On Wednesday, His Royal Highness the Duke of Gloucester opened the first post-war motor show at Earl's Court, with congratulations to the industry on its magnificent achievement of £100 million worth of cars exported since the war ended.
The new Morris Minor made its debut at the Earl's Court Motor Show in October 1948. Price, £358.10/7.
And here's something to goggle at. A brand new model announced only on the eve of the opening of the show. Here we see modern lines blended with sturdy performance at very low cost.
I was on the show stand with Alex Isigonis, and along came the technical engineer of General Motors America. And he came up and asked specifically to speak to Isigonis. And he went and looked around the vehicle with Isigonis, and he said, well, I congratulate you on a really excellent piece of packaging. Packaging being the American terms for getting a lot of people in a confined space. He was very, very pleased and really tickled Izzy Pink.
But this was the export-only show. The new models were for your eyes only. You could look, you could touch, but you couldn't drive them home. In the first 3 years, over 80% of Morris Minors were shipped overseas. The American market was a prime target. They had taken Rolls-Royces and MG sports cars to their hearts and garages, And now the showrooms were featuring a new car with deceptive looks.
The Morris Minor brings big car motoring at small car cost. Comfortable seating for 4 and 7 cubic feet of luggage space. All passengers sit within the wheelbase. That's why the Morris Minor gives greater comfort, increased stability, and easier driving control. A husky British bulldog engine with an easy shift, 4-speed transmission. Supreme road holding and a sway-free ride.
The top speed was less to shout about.
We went out with on the freeways with all the air chaps, four of us, in this poor little miner. And he flogged out about 60 miles an hour. That's all it would do, you know, 60 miles an hour. Of course, the other people were going 80 or 90 miles an hour on the Buicks and that sort of thing, you know. And they all thought it was a jolly good little car, bar it wasn't fast enough. It was underpowered, which it was.
The Americans didn't get a bigger engine, but in order to comply with the Californian law, the headlamps were raised to a new position above the front wings. Alec Izzigonis was furious about this, the only significant change ever made to the miner's shape. The export drive was relentless. No terrain was too rugged, no market too difficult to crack. The message went out all over the world.
La petite voiture la plus avantageuse du monde. La compra en coches pequeños más ventajosa del mundo. Der größte Wader der Welt in kleine Autos.
In 1950, the 100,000th Morris was exported. Lord Nuffield reluctantly praised the car.
Congratulations on the completion of the 100,000th car.
In the early 50s, government controls were relaxed and the home market took off. The model range expanded. There was a four-door version and eventually an estate car, the Morris Minor Traveller, available for £599.
The Morris Minor Traveller. It goes everywhere and does everything. You'll wonder how you ever managed without it.
In November 1951, Morris merged with its arch rival Austin, forming the British Motor Corporation. For the miner, this meant a new overhead valve engine and new opportunities to promote the car.
On the Goodwood Motor Race Circuit, a new kind of endurance test has been tried out on a Morris Minor. A specially designed mobile garage was in attendance for servicing, and the car, which was on a 10,000-mile trip to nowhere, doing about 1,000 miles a day, never stopped running under its own power.
The Morris Minor never drove past burning fields. It never had an operatic soundtrack and couldn't transform itself into a mobile computer. It was always promoted for its reliability. A long-life car whose every part had been tested, tested, and tested again. Although an improvement, the new Austin engine still couldn't take the Minor above 62 miles per hour. Finally, in September 1956, the Minor got what it had always wanted, a 948cc engine.
Big car features, big car driving ease, big car roominess, and now big car performance. A magnificent piece of power engineering designed to give you thousands of miles of trouble-free motoring. A surge of power on hills, breathtaking acceleration to whip you far away from traffic. It's the world-proved way to enjoy his sort of motoring in her sort of car. How nice to think that the car he wanted was just the car she wanted him to want.
London is a place well worth getting to know, and the best way of getting to know it is by car, the right car. The car that's just as much at home on the open road or in a crowded city street. The economical but lively Morris 1000.
With its not quite 1,000cc engine, the Miner was reborn as a rally car. Pat Moss was a champion show jumper before she took to motor racing in a green Morris Miner nicknamed Granny. 55.
Look out. I started on these little night rallies and some driving tests. I even did a hill climb. Anything that was competitive. It seemed perfectly natural to jump the horses at a show on a Saturday and then do a rally Saturday night.
Are you more nervous to say when you're going to the show jumping?
Oh, I think so, slightly.
We must compare the two. Which do you like best now?
Both. I couldn't say which. I wouldn't like to do one without the other.
Liège-Ramliège was in the 50s, 60s and before the most coveted rally, really. That was one of the first international rallies I did in the Morris Minor, and it was the first time that a car under 1,000cc had ever finished. It was very good, very reliable. Us Morris drivers hated the Austins. And the rivalry was terrific because, of course, the Austin was lighter, therefore faster. But we Morris drivers said the Morris Minor held the road better. I hit a concrete post once in the Minor, and Monty, and it was very icy. And I just overtaken an A30, and I was very pleased with that. Came down a slight slope into a village, and it sort of drifted, and I thought, oh, hell, I'm going to hit the snowbank. Which it did. No big drama, but there was a concrete post in it. My head was cut and so on, we lost time. But the car, we drove home after. It was no problem. They were very, very strong, but I didn't hit many things with them.
Well, there she is, a car they've made a million of.
My pal John says that their Miner is jolly comfortable. And there's massive room for them and their luggage.
Bill Anderson tells me the mine is the best car he ever had. Marvellous on corners. Bags of power. Miles and miles per gallon, too.
Gosh, everyone's got a Miner. Not everyone, silly. They're only made just over a million.
Let's have the million from first, eh?
In December 1960, it became the first British car to sell over a million. And to celebrate, a limited edition of 349 Morris Millions was produced in vivid lilac. But by now, the British Motor Corporation had new and even more innovative models designed by Alec Azzigonis. His front-wheel drive Mini and the 1100 model reinvented the small car. The Morris Minor was gradually becoming part of BMC's history.
The Morris Traveller car we produced at Cowley at a loss, and had we put that car together for nothing, in other words, assembled it for nothing, then we would still not have made any profit on it. We only just covered our overheads on that and made nothing out of it at all. I do remember on many occasions going to our salespeople and saying, for goodness sake, put the price up so that we can at any rate make a few pounds on it, but for some reason they never would.
As the 60s wore on, the Miner looked increasingly old-fashioned. Motorways had replaced country roads. Durability was no match for flash. The Miner was a fuddy-duddy's car.
Who dares come hooting at me? I only give way to a jag. You're balmy or plastered. I'll pass you, you bastard. I'll overtake you, I will. As he clenches his pipe, his moment is ripe, and the corner's accepting its kill.
The end finally came on November the 12th, 1970. When the last Miner 1000 rolled off the tracks at Cowley, followed a few months later by the final Traveller. But the miner didn't just rust away. Some people still thought that they were a good buy, and even a business proposition.
I had a tiny little business called Economy Motors, and while I was going to the auctions, I found that Morris Miners used to crop up. And the great thing, if you're in the banger end of the market, is that the car should start. And I found that these funny little Morris Miners always used to start. And also, they used to get you home from the auction, you know, while one would be pushing the odd Ford or Vauxhall up the hill, you know, the Morris would always get you home. I then thought, well, maybe there is an area one could specialise in. Of course, at that time, I mean, you could go to auctions and buy Morris Miners by the dozen, and the army used to sell off them by the hundreds, so that getting the stock was no great problem. I think the other thing was that the sort of brand loyalty was quite extraordinary, that as soon as I started selling Morris Miners, one got a different class of person, as they say, or punter, coming into the yard. And they were all serious people who actually wanted simple A to B transport. And that if you had something that worked, and you also explained why it wasn't perfect, that they were the sort of people who would actually accept that cars are not necessarily perfect. That you didn't have to do a big sales hype in order to shift the metal, as they say in the motor trade.
Into reverse. Rev the engine. Clutch back until it just begins to fade. Handbrake off. Turn the wheel right round to the left. Right round, down with the clutch. Straighten the wheel up. Stop now. Now, handbrake. Into first. Rev it a little. Clutch back till it just begins to fade. Get the wheel right round. Quickly, down with the clutch. Dear, dear, dear. Right round with the wheel.
I've run this Morris Miner since 1976, teaching people to drive. It has done 370,000 miles, 340,000 of them with learner drivers. I run it because it's simple to maintain, simple to drive, and I don't spend all my weekends servicing it. Change the oil every 10,000 miles, and a bit of welding underneath every MOT usually. I look at it, why tie 10,000 up in a car when you can tie 500 up in the car to do the same job? So many of these modern cars, you have to have specialised equipment because they design them that way to stop you fiddling about with them. Or people like me fiddling about with them.
In the days when these first monocoques were made and when car design engineering was developing, they tended to build in extra strength, a bit for luck, as it were. It certainly made the car slightly heavier than a modern car, but at the same time meant that it was maintainable, it was durable, and was not likely to collapse. Certainly no normal modern Eurobox has that kind of structural life, because they're not perceived in that way. But with this, you can go on cutting it out just in the way that one can cut brickwork or stone out of a house and replace new stone, you can replace joists, you can cut the dry rot out and put back the new material. You can do that right the way through the car, because the whole thing was put together by people, and therefore what has been put together by people can be taken apart by people. See them all over Asia. I mean, there are 20,000 alone in Sri Lanka, and something like 35,000 in Malaysia, the taxis in Islamabad are Morris Minors, and they're Morris Minors in India. I mean, they're everywhere where the old empire stretched.
In 1980, Charles Ware went to Sri Lanka to see their Morris Minors in action. 3 years later, he met his partner, Dhanapala Samarasekara, and the durable car company was born.
The factory opened on the 20th of April, 1991. What we're doing is building up from a very small workshop situation of, say, 50 or 60 people, to 1,000 people over the next 4 years. And during that time, we will be making components for the Morris Minor, initially. Then we will be building sub-assemblies. We will then be building possibly body shells or sufficient panels for those body shells to be assembled in the UK and all over Southeast Asia. From my having roamed around the world looking at Morris Minors in all kinds of countries, I think the thing is it's a damn good car. You know, that's the way they look on it in Asia, you know, that it bloody well works. It again is took things from all over the world, in a sense, to design the car, but he put them together in an individual way. So I don't think it's a sort of, I don't think it's really a kind of English noddy car. I think it's one of the great design classics.
All design is a battle, you know. It's a battle between cost and efficiency, for a start. It's a battle between people with different ideas. Some people value one thing, some another, you see.
The salespeople would say the sort of car that they wanted, and Dizzy Gonis would say, well, this is the sort of car you're going to have, because this is the car that is going to be successful. And he was absolutely convinced he was right. And in the event, of course, he was.
It's like having a toy, isn't it, that you're very fond of? It's almost alive, the Minor, isn't it, compared to some of the other cars?
With steerability, second to none. Corner ability, second to none. Life on the vehicle, second to none. Put the lot together, you have a Morris Minor.
Top Gear is preparing a new series of 10 programmes on popular classic cars, and it begins this autumn on BBC Two.